I want to share. Hello, I'm back again, and I would like to share something with you which I've read some years ago and which I recently read again, and it is so powerful and so encouraging. First, I want to pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank you that I may share something. I'm inviting you and the Holy Spirit into my life and to all who are listening and watching now, that you will make some changes in us and that this will be to your glory and to your honor, that we will live the life you have intended for us. And these verses are very encouraging, and perhaps we have lost our job or dear one, or we are very sick or discouraged or anxiously. Kindly help us. We are casting all our burdens on you as you are caring for us. And let us understand your word. I'm asking this in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The necessity of constant growth in grace. 2 Peter 1 verse 10. Therefore, the other brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure, for if you do these things, you shall never fall. Growth in grace. Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior Jesus Christ. Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, according as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, through the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given us unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these ye might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Grace and peace be multiplied unto us through the knowledge of God. It is not one time or two times or two portions of grace and peace. It shall be multiplied through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. According this divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. This is a big one. I have thought about this very, very long time. You were thinking, oh, he is promising that we get everything we need to our life, which is necessary. It does not mean that we will be rich, but he will give us all the things which pertain unto life and godliness, which is much more important, to the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises. I don't know what to say. The Lord is giving us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these he might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust, the divine nature, not strife and cheating, backbiting. No, the divine nature, it is so, so good. Verse 5, which is 2 Peter 1, move from verse 5 to 10. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness charity. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind and cannot see afar off, and have forgotten that he was purged from his all sins. Now the conclusion. Therefore, you other brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. When we are giving all diligence and we are adding to our faith virtue, and I will come back to this in another talk, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance. This is very important, because I know we all have some problems with it, me too. But the Lord is good, he is giving us a way of escape after 1 Corinthians 10:30, and to temperance, patience, and to patience, godliness. This is a step for step, and these virtues are developing at the same time. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. In the German, it is the love to our people. That means we will be able to love everybody, also our enemies. This is really big. Or bad colleague we don't like, or the lady who is always cheating or is talking bad things about us or others. We love them all. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that you neither shall be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. When this is getting more and more in us, then we will know our Lord Jesus Christ. If he would like us, he thinks he's blind and can't see far off. He has forgotten that he was purged from his old sins. That means the man or the lady who got to know all these things and forgot it, they have forgotten that they were cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ, who died for us on the cross. He suffered so much for us. He came down from heaven. He is the Son of God, and he is the Creator, and he suffered so much, and he took the form of a human being on him to live the life as we are living, and he didn't have any advantage because he laid his godly authority beside. He was living a life as us, and he got the power to overcome by his Heavenly Father. In the same way, we are allowed to experience the same by the power of our dear Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that we can may live. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you shall never fall. This we shall do. So an entrance to the ministry and to abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and his Savior Jesus Christ, that we may come to heaven. We may be there forever and ever, and Jesus is looking for us, he's waiting on us, he's missing us. He wants you and me to heaven. He wants to have a so close relationship between you and him that is we can't imagine, but this is the case. He loves everybody of us, you and me. With what words does the Apostle Peter close his second epistle? But growing grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. 2 Peter 3, verse 18. We shall grow in grace, and we have just got the steps how we can grow into it. We're only looking unto Jesus and trusting him. I know this is a big challenge, but with the help of the Lord, it is possible. How may grace and peace be multiplied in believers? Grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. When we get to know him, when we are making experiences with him, then we will know him. And grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. You can tell a little experience. I'm working, and as I want to have free on Sabbath and in the winter time also on Friday because I'm having 12-hour shifts. I was asking for it. And I was talking with the leader of this firm where I'm working for. And he said, this I can't grant you, but you are allowed to help out if there is a need of some people to care for a lady. So I'm helping a lady. And I said, it's okay. I asked my husband, he said, it is okay. And the first month was terrible. I didn't have not so many shifts, but it got better. And then we had to introduce two new colleagues. One of them was not really honest, and she did some things that she got fired. And the other one who was really reliable and reasonable, she did not get the help from the firm I'm working for. I was very sad about it. We all were very sad about it because there's need of help. But she quit, she got another job. Then we were we were asked to think about what we should do and to make timetable for our work. The others were asking me, and I am not, I don't have this job on a regular basis. So we said, okay, I will try it. And I gave it a try. At first, it was very difficult for me because I was thinking I have to make shifts for about 6 weeks. And it was not, I couldn't manage it in then. I was praying, and the Lord helped me to make a shift only for 1 week, this 4 or 5 persons, and then the next, and then the next, and try to get that all have enough hours. It's just not unjust or unrighteous. And I didn't understand it to the lady at the firm who was looking after us, and she was thinking, And I was really astonished about it because I was praying, I was very sad to lose the job, to have less income. And now, today, I had to go there, it is Friday, and I said, I only want to work exceptionally because if they couldn't find another person to help this lady, I can only stay there until 4:15, because about shortly before 4 o'clock the summer could begin. Okay, he said, yes, it's good. And then I went. And in the meantime, I told the lady who's looking after us at the farm that I was not able to make some food for tomorrow for the summer. And she said, it's okay. And then in the meantime, the afternoon, I got a telephone call and she was asking me, Angela, where are you living? I said, I'm living down there. And they gave her my address. She said, I want to send you some flowers. This was great for me because I never expected it. And I don't want to boast me, but it is to the glory of God because the Lord says, who is honoring me, I will honor. It's incredible, and I was like, wow, I was really astonished, and I'm very thankful. It is warming my heart. They were not treating me so well, but I thought, okay, it's fine because I want to have you on Sabbath. And I'm really satisfied, and I'm very glad about it. And this was a little experience. So we are continuing. What has our Heavenly Father given to us to enable us to become partakers of the divine nature? 2 Peter 1 verse 4. Whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these we might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. When we are listening to this word lust, we are thinking on sexual lust, but it is not only this way, it is also eating. Intemperance, when we're eating too much or too late, or we are working too much or staying up too late and not going early to bed,
All the things are also to have to like it, to watch some things which are not good for us, for our moral being, that we can be upright Christians. We may be partakers of the divine nature while we can speak, and we may escape the corruption that is in the world through us, and we can pray for it when we are struggling with it. And the Lord will help us because in His word He's saying it, and He's saying we can ask for it. Sometimes in His promises there are conditions. There is one condition, to escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. But He's also giving at the same time a promise that this is possible. And He can pray, dear Lord, help me to escape the corruption that is in the world through lust. It can be everything. It can also be ambition or pride. Yeah. What graces or qualities of character are we to add in our character building? Add to your faith virtue, into virtue knowledge, into knowledge temperance, that means self-control, and to temperance patience, into patience godliness, into godliness brotherly kindness, into brotherly kindness charity. Now, faith is the first round in the Christian ladder. The first step God does. He that cometh to God must believe. Hebrews 11, verse 6. But an inoperative faith is useless. Faith without works is dead. James 2, verse 20. To be of value, there must be coupled with faith virtue or moral excellence in the nursing honor, which they don't have. But the ladder is wide open. We may add virtue to virtue. And don't be discouraged of these things because the Lord is doing it in us. It is not as we have. If I'm doing it on my own and I won't succeed, it will be a big failure. But the Lord can give us the power when we are asking. And I know every day we are so quick to say something wrong and to do something wrong, but we can be asking Jesus that He will help us and to be humble and patient and to believe in Him, because that's the point where we also are struggling, because we can't see Him. He's not here like your husband or your wife or your children or your grandchildren or your colleagues or friends. But He wants to live in your heart. And therefore, when you are making some experiences with Him, then you are on the first step God wants. You must believe that He is the being He has created the world. And we have may do some works which is in accordance to that what we believe. Otherwise, our faith would be dead. And the faith must be coupled with virtue or moral excellence. If we can't do it for our own, Jesus will do it in us. Add to your faith virtue, into virtue knowledge, into knowledge temperance, into temperance patience, and so on. How may we obtain knowledge of Christ? Studying His word on a daily basis, His life, a good prayer life, having communion with Him via prayer, having Him as our divine Savior and Redeemer and Godly Father, studying a really good book about Him. Jesus can be our friend and our Savior and our God. We need to get to know Him, to get a relationship with Him, that we are coming very close to Him as much as possible. How to get to know Jesus? Bible study and use a really good book, which is called The Desire of Ages from Ellen G. White. It is describing all His life, and I love it. It is warming the heart when studying and reading it. And the chapters are based on Bible chapters, and you can see the quote in the beginning of every chapter, and you can see that nice picture in it. A tree of life, virtue, into virtue, knowledge, into knowledge, temperance, self-control, into pride, temperance, patience, into patience, godliness, into godliness, brotherly kindness, into brotherly kindness, charity. Temperance, self-control, unto pride, temperance, patience. Patience is very important. There's another biotic in the Bible. Here is patience of the saints. Sometimes we are so impatient. Me too. It's very normal. We are only humans. But when I'm looking at Jesus, Jesus is getting influenced on us. And so he says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus with this revelation, what he must pray. Patience is very necessary. Into patience, godliness. Yeah. And godliness, brotherly kindness. It is in this in this order. And to godliness, brotherly kindness, into brotherly kindness, charity. Charity. What does the Bible tell us about charity? Charity sounds long and is kind. Charity envies not. Charity mounts not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endures all things, 1 Corinthians 13:47. And above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. First part, the first referential starting, it is like a sign, it is about the love of God is having to us, and which we are called to develop in this way. Don't be picked up. If we won't behave unseemly and thinking on people barely close or being naughty, saying bad words, not seeking help, seeking the other's best, not easily provoked, because some people they like to provoke us. But if this is the case, we can say it will not help me now because I keep coming. I think we're not even, and we are not glad about the iniquity, but we're trusting the truth. Bearing all things, being sick, because when somebody, for example, is tortured, this is really good, but the Lord is good, he can do these things. Charity believes all things, hope is all things, and you are all things. I think we all have to learn these things, me too, but I can't. But the Lord is able, and we are looking unto him. Above all these things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. This is very important, because what does it help when I have a friend or a good friend, or relatives who are doing bad stuff, and I'm going and telling it all the people I know. Charity shall cover the multitude of things that we can bring it to Jesus. But sometimes our heart is so full of this bad stuff that we can't quiet, then we have to tell about it. Let's go to Jesus. I invite you to learn. What is another name for charity? And above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfection. Very good. Putting on charity, and this is a bond of perfection, to be unselfish, not only thinking of ourselves, but also helping others, helping poor people who don't have anything, who will need help, who don't understand something. Very Try trying if somebody does not understand it and you want to explain it, the person is always asking, what does it mean? I don't understand it. But then you can ask, you know, dear Lord, help me with ambition. And also having enough love for this person, because this is the bond of perfection. What is the condition of one who lets these graces? But he is a negative thing, blind and cannot see far. And has forgotten that he was purged from his old state. I have talked about this, that when they don't have this charity or the other qualifications, we are blind. Because we are only looking on our own and not on the situation of the other person. We are looking unto Jesus. What would Jesus do? In this case, when I have to explain something perhaps 20 or 30 times, and I think, oh. But, we are blind. We are honestly in our own. Therefore, we need love from God's charity to help us when we are learning them. What promise is given to those who will patiently add grace to faith? It is worse than if you do these things, you shall never fall. This is a good point. We are doing this, but we have to learn the step by step. God in grace. This is from the book Acts of the Apostles. Before the believer is set out, the wonderful possibility of being like Christ. He describes the wonderful possibility of being like Christ, obedient to all the principles of the world. All the principles of the world. You can find them in Exodus chapter 24, verse 1 to 17. But of himself, man is utterly unable to reach this condition. The holiness that God declares must have before he can be saved is the result of the working of divine grace as he bows in submission to the discipline and restraining influences of the Spirit of truth. His holiness sometimes expects that you don't say the word, that you don't react on some irritations or some circumstances where you think, oh no, I can't stand it. But the Spirit of truth is hiding us. Man's obedience can be made perfect only by the interest of Christ's righteousness, which fills with divine fragrance every act of obedience. By the interest of Christ's righteousness. The part of the Christian is to persevere in overcoming every fault in the world, which faults we have. Oftentimes it's in this way that I think, oh no, I'm so bad in this stuff. I'm not so good in it. And then I have to be very, very careful. Constantly he is to pray to the Savior to hear the disorders of his things himself. He has not the wisdom or the strength to overcome. These belong to the Lord. And he bestows them on those who in humiliation and contrition seek him for him. We can't. But the Lord, and he's giving them those who are humble and who are contrite and ask him for help. This is so good. The work of transformation from unholiness to holiness is a continuous one. It doesn't happen in one day. It's a work of a lifetime. Day by day, God labors for man's sanctification, and man is to cooperate with him, putting forth persevering efforts in the cultivation of right habits. It's very important. He is to add grace to grace, and as he thus works on the plan of addition, God works for him on the plan of multiplication. Our Savior is always ready to hear and answer the prayer of the contrite heart, and grace and peace are multiplied to his faithful ones. Gladly, he grants them the blessings they need in their struggle against the evils that beset them, from outside, but also from inside. Gladly, Jesus grants us the blessings that we need in the time of struggle. This is what it is. What God is doing is not us. There are those who attempt to ascend the ladder of Christian progress, but as they advance, they begin to put their trust in the power of man and soon lose sight of Jesus, the author and finisher of their faith. The result is failure, the loss of all that has been gained. Sad indeed is the condition of those who, becoming weary of the faith, allow the enemy of souls to rob them of the Christian graces that have been developing in their hearts and lives. He that lacketh these things, declares the apostle, is blind and cannot see afar off, and has forgotten that he was purged from his old sin. This is what he said, that it is happening very, very easily. Therefore, we have to be on guard, on guard, that it won't happen, that we are trying to have a living connection with Jesus. Here's an example. The apostle Peter had a long experience with the things of God. His faith in God's power to save had strengthened for 3 years until he had proved beyond question that there is no possibility of failure before the one who, advancing by faith, ascends round by round, ever upward and onward to the topmost round of the ladder that reaches even to the portals of heaven. He had proved this, that there is no possibility of failure when we are climbing up this ladder. I don't know what to say. It's so good. And then you can also see. For many years, Peter had been arguing upon the believers the necessity of a constant growth in grace and in the knowledge of the truth. And now, knowing that soon he would be called to suffer martyrdom for his faith, he once more drew attention to the precious privileges within the reach of every believer. In the full assurance of his faith, the aged disciple exhorted his brethren to steadfastness of purpose in the Christian life. Give diligence, he pleaded, to make your calling and election sure. But if you do these things, ye shall never fall. For so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Precious assurance. Glorious is the hope before the believer as he advances by faith toward the hope of Christian perfection. You want to be with it? I want. Also, if I see today, I see long away, far away from it. But let's try for this. To climb this ladder, because when we are climbing it, there won't be no faith. Because we see it in the example of people. I will not be negligent, the apostle continued, to put your honors in remembrance of these things, though you know them, and be established in the present truth. Yes, I think it means, as long as I am in this tabernacle, to steer you up by putting you in your memories, knowing the shortly I must put off this my tabernacle, even as our Lord Jesus Christ is shortly. Moreover, I will endeavor that he may be able after my decease to have these things always in your memory. I'm sorry that I said it so often, but we have to remember it and we are so forgetful. Me too. Therefore, it is good to study the Bible. You can see it from this view, and also from another view, and read it again and again, and pondering about it, because the Lord wants us to reach this center, to come up to the top of it, that we will have the charity and all the other things. The apostle was well qualified to speak of the purposes of God concerning the human race. But during the earthly ministry of Christ, he had seen and heard much that pertained to the kingdom of God. We have not followed cunningly devised fables, he reminded the believers, when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received from God the Father honor and glory. When there came such a voice to him from the excellent glory, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am very pleased. And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with him in the holy mount. He was an eyewitness, and he heard it. Denn Jesus schuf sie von Gott, der Vater, Honor und Glauben. Sie sind Gott, Gott und Christ. Und der Apostel war wirklich qualified to speak of all these things. And I hope you will also be qualified to do it. The world needs workers in the Lord's vineyard. And we can pray for it. And then there is a sure word of prophecy, which Peter was declaring with this morning. Yet convincing as was this evidence of the certainty of the believer's hope, there was another still more convincing in the witness of prophecy, through which the faith of all might be confirmed and securely anchored. This we should have, that our faith might be confirmed and truly anchored, securely anchored, because it's a witness, and it is making us more bold in the things of God when we see that the prophecies are fulfilling, and we can see today that they are fulfilling. Therefore, says, declared Peter, we have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shines in a dark place, until the day dawn and the day star arise in your heart, knowing this first, that no prophecy of the scriptures is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in all time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. It is not or onwards, or the prophets were, they were moved by the Holy Ghost. And when those prophecies are fulfilling, you can see that they are reliable, that the word of God is reliable, as you and me are sitting on a chair or somewhere else doing something and listening. It is so sure. And we can see today that the prophecies are fulfilling. I'm thinking on Revelation, and at the later part of time, I want to begin to share this first Daniel and then Revelation. While exalting the sure word of prophecy as a safeguard in times of peril, the apostles solemnly warned the church against the charge of false prophecy, which would be uplifted by false teachers who would privily bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord. Today the case, but it was also the case. The sure word of prophecy is a safe guide in times of peril, but we are experienced today. Is it an easy time we are living in now? I don't think so. I see that the circumstances, they are becoming worse and worse, a bit here, a bit more there, and we need the sure word of prophecy to see where we are in this timeline until Jesus is coming again. There is another good book, which is called The Great Controversy, from the same author. You can find it on the internet. It is very commendable to study it, especially the last third part of it, because it's about our time. These false teachers arising in the church is accounted true by many of the brethren in the faith. They are unfortunately compared to wells without water, clouds that are carried with the tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. The latter end is worse with them, he declared, than the beginning, for it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. It's very dangerous. And how can we find out if this teacher is a true one or a false one? You can see it on his fruits as he uses it again. And there's also another one, just to find the word. Take one moment. Either this is this or the other. This is Desire 820. Some of you will know it. To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them, and they are not saying to the law and to the testimony, then there is no light in them. Looking down through the ages to the close of time, Peter was inspired to outline conditions that would exist in the world just prior to the second coming of Christ. Now he's telling, and kindly compare it with the circumstances we are living under and with the people. There shall come in the last days scoffers, he wrote, walking after their own lusts and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the Father fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. But when they say peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them. First Thessalonians, then Thessalonians. Just recently, there was a meeting with all the churches and denominations, and perhaps also other, not only Christian churches. They met with the Pope and they had a feast to come together. This peace and safety, you can find it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. Not all, however, would be ensnared by the enemy's device. As the end of all things earthly should approach, there would be faithful ones able to discern the signs of the time. While a large number of professing believers would deny their faith by their works, there would be a remnant who would endure to the end. Let's pray for that we will be under the remnant, that we don't won't deny our faith by our works. Let's pray and study and see what the Word of God is saying to all these points. Peter kept alive in his heart the hope of Christ's return, and he assured the church of the certain fulfillment of his Savior's promise. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. John 14:3. To the tried and faithful ones, the coming might seem long delayed, but the apostle assured them, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long suffering to us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also, and the works that are therein shall be burned. The Lord is waiting on us, that we will prepare and be ready for his return, that he wants to come very soon. The signs of the times are showing that he will come very, very soon. And then all these things will happen. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought it to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be destroyed, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. What manner of persons ought we to be when Jesus is coming? Can we continue with seeking and killing or stealing, looking on other men or women, having hatred in our hearts? Can we continue with these things when the Lord is coming? No, we can't. If the Lord is God, today is a day where we can repent and come to the Lord as he says. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, that he will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It is in 1 John 1 verse 9. Today is the time to come back to God, and I'm asking you, come back to God. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that you look for such things, be diligent that you may be found of him in peace, without spot and blemish. And account that the long suffering of our Lord is salvation, Even as our beloved father Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, has written unto you. Yea, therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This the Lord is expecting from us. Be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace without spot and blame. And let us not be led away with the error of the wicked and fall from our own steadfastness. But we have to be careful. We can't think, oh no, I'm standing fairly sure, but in the next moment the evil one or person is irritating you. And then we are falling. But we can look unto Jesus and focus on him, that we may grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, because he knows everything. He knows how to behave in every situation. In the providence of God, Peter was permitted to close his ministry in Rome, where his imprisonment was ordered by the Emperor Nero about the time of Paul's final arrest. Thus, the two veteran apostles, who for many years had been widely separated in their labors, were to bear their last witness for Christ in the world's metropolis and upon its soil to shed their blood as the seed of a raised harvest of saints and martyrs in this city. They were prepared to believe it. It is easy to talk about it. I don't know where we will stand one day if we will stand here. If we are prepared to give our lives for the sake of Jesus and his cross, let's be prepared. First, he will be with us in every situation, as he is saying in Matthew 28. You know it very well. Just to find it. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Therefore we can claim his promises. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. You will be ever with us. It doesn't matter in which situation we are, and maybe he is with us. And we are never alone, but his own holy angels are with us. And if necessary, a great number, and we can pray for it when we feel unsecure or are on dangerous ground. That the Lord will help us out of this situation and keep us and bear us through it. His reinstatement after his denial of Christ, Peter had unflinchingly braved danger and had shown a noble courage of preaching a crucified, risen, and ascended Savior. As he lay in his cell, he called to mind the words that Christ had spoken to him. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, there's not much left to read. As he lay in his cell, he called to mind the word that Christ had spoken to him. Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when you shall be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hand, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. John 21, verse 18. Thus Jesus had made known to the disciples the very manner of his death, and even foretold the stretching of his hands upon the cross. This could be our case. There's also another group in the Bible which is mentioned, for example, in Revelation chapter 14, verse 1-5. 144,000, they will live, they won't see death. But many of the believing people of the remnant they will relate to death, or they have to die as Peter is martyrdom. But the Lord is preparing us for all the things, as he is saying, if this will be the case, and we will come into difficult times. It is Revelation 2 verse 10. Fear none of those things which those shall suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that you may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. That was be faithful unto death. Peter the Jew and the foreigner was condemned to be scourged and crucified. In prospect of his fearful death, the apostle remembered his great sin in denying Jesus in the hour of his trial, and how often have we done it in our life. Once so unready to acknowledge the cross, he now counted it a joy to yield up his life for the gospel, feeling only that for him who had denied his Lord to die in the same manner as his master died was too great an honor. Peter had sincerely repented of that sin and had been forgiven by Christ, as is shown by the high commission given him to feed the sheep and lambs of the flock. But he could never forgive himself. Not even the thought of the agonies of the last terrible scene could lessen the bitterness of his sorrow and repentance. As a last favor, he entreated his executioners that he might be nailed to the cross with his head downward. The request was granted, and in this manner died the grave of prostitution. What a death. He showed a great honor to die the same death on the cross, but he felt unworthy to do it in the same way that he suffered. He was nailed to the cross with his head down. What suffering for the cross, for the cross of Jesus and his kingdom. And Peter was so sorry of what he has done. And I know I've lived a life in some, well, many things. I'm not really good what I have done. And let's think about it, but let's not be scared, because Jesus is loving us. He wants us to be safe. Now I want to come to an end, and I want to pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for your loving kindness. You suffered so much for us, and died for our sins on the cross, that whosoever believes in you should not perish but have everlasting life. We thank you for that gift, that you want us to be with you in heaven. We are asking for your grace to grow into the full stature of men and women in Christ after your work. Let us be prepared if you are coming very soon, and help us with many people who come to get to know you. Let's strive to be under the faithful one, and if possible under the 144,000, but your will be done, not ours. And I'm asking and praying in the precious name of our dear Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you very much for listening. And you may have a good time. And let's think about it. And I am also to think about it.